Good morning. We're just going to play music for 20 minutes before church starts, so if you know the song, sing along. We didn't print these ones. It would have been a book, but it's okay. This is Great Are You, Lord.
Rock.
I don't know how many of you sent your kids to Bible school this week, but we had 100 kids singing this song at the end of Bible school. It was fantastic. Okay, this one isn't in your bulletin. I just thought we should do it this morning.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, and I will sing of the goodness of God. And all my life you have been. The goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend.
This song gives a moment to the bass player. She never gets any credit, so.
I'm going down that glory road. I'm going down that glory road. Glory, hallelujah, praise God, amen. I'm going down that glory road. I'm going down.
Yeah, I get it. I was raised Lutheran. It's okay. Been converted. Above the head clapper. It's all right. We're in the park, so nobody's any religion this morning. We're just Christians. We're just hanging out, worshiping God this morning. All right. You guys know this song. What's that? I don't know what Methodists are toe tappers. Don't think that the whole Methodist church is raising their hand clapping in church over there. It's probably just me and maybe one person. You're not alone. All right, this is Amazing Grace. Ready? Oh. One, two, three, four. Last of our prelude songs, but this is a
Another kid favorite from Bible school. Man, those kids can sing. Who got a chance to listen to them sing this week?
Yeah.
Fantastic.
If you could imagine 100 kids seriously singing at the top of their lungs. Some kids were opening their hands and singing to the sky. Like, it was like amazing. I don't know, Leah Tweet's kids. She must sing with them at home. But they're on pitch too, and they just sing. I don't know, they're just beautiful.
Yep.
Did you get to hear them?
I did not.
Oh, it's on the Facebook page. Yep. Go listen to it. It's on the Methodist Church Facebook page. I think Laura Traumas shared it to the Redeemer Free one too as well. So yeah, go listen and see what that's all about, because it's pretty fabulous. This is Lighthouse. Am I getting tired of being those at homie? You hear that?
Yeah.
In my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, whoa. You are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In my questions, your truth will hold. Love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, whoa. You are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe.
Good morning, church. Good to see all of you here. You know, we prayed for a nice day. I think God answered that, huh?
I'm Pastor Tom Gelman out at Redeemer Free Lutheran Church, and on behalf and in the name of Jesus Christ, on behalf of the Canton Ministerial Association, I want to welcome all of you to this year's community service in the park, and we're going to come before God this morning as His people. You know, in a little bit, Pastor Kevin Schneider is going to speak, And I know his text, I don't know what he's going to say, but I know his text is in Deuteronomy chapter 6. And in that verse, I'm just going to say this. It says, take care lest
you forget the Lord your God. We as a ministerial in this community, and I know that you are partners in that, are here to help people, to help others to not forget. And I thank you for not forgetting the Lord your God this morning and coming here to worship him. I would invite you to join in the words printed in our call to worship in your bulletin this morning. In the dark print, please join in. We are called to love the Lord our God.
We are called to love the Lord our God.
We are called to love with all our mind and strength.
We are called to love the Lord our God.
We are called to love our neighbor as ourselves.
Come, let us love our God.
We will share God's love in this time of worship.
I invite you to join with me in the prayer that is printed before you. Let's pray. Loving, living God, be among us now. Show us your ways. Guide our steps. Live in us, that we may be people of steadfast hope and powerful giving. Help us hear your words, challenging us to give you all the things that are yours. Help us to remember that all we are and all we have are gifts from you, gifts to be shared in service and love. Holy One among us, help us be a holy people who receive your word with joy and live your message with love. And I'd like to just say a word here. I know that a number of our leaders of our churches in town are either away with family or on ministry business or in a hospital bed. And Pastor Sheldon Hobalt is the one in the hospital bed, and he wanted to be here with us. And I'd like to just pray for him and those who are away this morning. But he's got an infection in his leg. He's on three different antibiotics, his wife tells me this morning, up in Sioux Falls at the hospital. And we're just going to pray for quick healing. And I would invite you to bow with me as we do that. Father God, first of all, Lord, thank you for a beautiful morning. And thank you that your word is faithful and true. And when you say your mercies are new every morning, we stand under your mercy. So, Lord, we lift those this morning who are not able to be here, whether members of our churches, for whatever their reasons, or those who are away with family, or those who are representing you in different places with ministry, or those who are in hospital beds. And Lord, there are many. We lay them all before your grace and mercy. Specifically, we lift up Pastor Hobalt. And we ask, Father, that by your touch, you would bring healing to his body. This infection would leave him, and he would be presented before you and his people clean and healthy and strong.
Lord, thank you for your presence in our midst. Anoint Pastor Kevin as he shares your word. Anoint this gathered people, your church, who gladly and freely give you worship and praise. In Jesus' name.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to feel, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, my God. shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun for men shine, but God called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine. My chains are
of forgiveness. As the Apostle Paul reminds us, we have all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We are justified freely by his grace. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Good morning, everyone. We probably need to do a little bit better than that because, you know, you guys are way back. There's a lot of space up front here. If any of you guys in back want to move up front, that'd be awesome. I know you guys want shade, but here's the deal. I'm going to say good morning. You can say good morning back. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Hey, there we go. That's what I love. Hey, just for those of you who don't know me, my name is Pastor Kevin. And I've been part of Bethany Church for about the past 6 months, going on 7 months. And so it is my privilege and honor to be able to come and share with you this morning. I want to tell you just a little bit about me so that you have an idea of who you're listening to today and the things that go on. I actually grew up on a farm down by Akron, Iowa, and moved away, and 35 years later got to move back to the farm, and I pastored a church in Sioux Falls for many years. And you know, the amazing thing is that I kind of have a connection with some people from Canton. I mean, not that I'm still mad about it, but back in the early 80s, I was a wrestler for Akron, and it was the finals of the wrestling tournament in Akron. It was the finals, and I got beat by a kid from Canton. So, oh yeah, woo! Wade Mirabeau was his name. He beat me in the finals, and so, I mean, I'm not sore about it or anything. Not mad, but that goes way back. And so, you know, another thing that you might want to know about me is that I love history. There's something about being able to look back and learn from the things that have happened. In fact, one of my favorite parts of history is the Civil War. And in 3 weeks, here in Canton, there's going to be a reenactment of some Civil War stuff. And so to be a part of that and to see that and go to it is amazing. In fact, I had an opportunity years ago to study at Gettysburg. And so I spent a bunch of time on the battlefield walking around and just looking and seeing and being reminded of the things of history. Which then made me wonder this. How well do you know the history of Canton? Anybody lived in Canton their entire life? A few of you. You've been here your entire life. So I've got a couple questions here, a few questions that I want to ask you about the history of Canton, because having only been here about 7 months, I needed to know some of the history. So I've been studying this week on the history of Canton. So here's a question. Anybody know the first visitor that was recorded, the first visitor to Canton? Anybody know his name? It wasn't Kevin Schneider either. I mean, the beard is white, but I'm not that old. His name was Lewis Hyde. Lewis Hyde. How about this? In 1861, we had our first person who came to this area and began to simply live here and to homestead this area. Anybody know his name? There we go. Thank you. 1861. Anybody know the name of the first person who homesteaded this area? Nobody? His name was August Linderman. August Linderman's the first person to put a homestead here in Canton. Here's a question. Anybody know where the name Canton came from? Yeah.
Canton, China.
Canton, China. That's right. The people who homesteaded this area thought that they were exactly the opposite on the earth of Canton, China. So that's how Canton got its name. Anybody know in 1868 there was a huge influx of migrants? Anybody want to take a guess where those migrants were from? Norway. They were the Norwegians. Yes, Norwegians. Here you go. 1872, the first newspaper for Canton was put out. Anybody want to guess the name of the newspaper?
Sioux Valley News.
That's right. So the paper today has the same name as the first paper in 1872. Here you go, another thing. In 1880, there was a big change that took place for Canton. Anybody want to take a guess at what that was? What came to Canton in 1880 that changed this community? The railroad. Yes, it was the railroad. It was called the Chicago, Milwaukee, St. Paul, and Pacific Railroad. It crossed the Big Sioux River, which was a big deal in 1880. Now, here you go. Anybody want to take a guess at a famous place here in town? The Ski Hill? Okay. How about a house? What's the mansion here in town? The Kennedy Mansion. How about the not-so-famous building here in town that many people are trying to forget? Yes, the Hiawatha Indian Insane Asylum.
that many people try to forget. And then one more question for you. How many churches are there in Canton? Close. Eight, a little more. 10, a little more. 11. You guys are close. Everybody's kind of around it there. So 11 different churches would call Canton home. Again, just some of our history of the town and the community of Canton. We are 3,000 plus people who call Canton home now. And so I wonder this, is history or the history of Canton, is it important? Does it make a difference if we know any of that? For many of us, we would say this, well, it's really not a matter of life and death, right? But there is something to knowing where we came from. There's something about knowing the past, something about knowing our history that I think is important for us. And in fact, that huge influx of Norwegians helps me understand again the background of who many of us are, where we came from, and for those of us who call Canton home. But as I began to thinking about history, I also wondered this. Is it important for us as a community to understand the history of Scripture? Is it a big deal? Like we said in the bulletins, we read through the prayer stuff, and that confession, many of us said this. For many of us, when is our faith important? Sunday mornings, maybe Wednesday afternoons, or Wednesday evenings, and whenever we ask God to rescue us. That becomes those moments when we say, man, I really need my faith. I need God to move. I need God to be active and a part of who I am. But I wondered this again as I began to think about this week and thinking about history. Is what happens in the Scriptures important? And so I landed as I was studying Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6. Today we're going to look at verses 4 through 12. And if you brought your Bible, I invite you to open it with me and look along. Because honestly, this part of Scripture in Deuteronomy chapter 6, it was written by a man by the name of Moses. And when Moses wrote this, he was simply getting close to leading the people into the promised land. And he wrote these words as a reminder to the people that he was leading. Now understand this. When he wrote these words will actually become some of the most important and sacred words to the Jewish people. That if you are a Jewish person and you are a person of faith, you will recite these words three times a day, every day. Because for you, these words are life. And these words are your past and this connection that you have not only to Moses, but to God. So Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 12, it says this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them to your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. When the Lord your God brings you into the land he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give you, a land with large, flourishing cities you did not build, houses filled with all kinds of good things you did not provide, wells you did not dig, and vineyards you did not plant. Then when you eat and are satisfied, be careful that you do not forget the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. See, as I was reading that, and I was pondering that, there's that moment when you get to verse 12, and it says this, and when you are in the land a land that is flourishing, a land that God has given you, a land of houses and wells and vineyards, and you've got food and shelter and everything that you need. Make sure that you don't do one thing, and that is forget. Do not forget your God. And you know what? The amazing thing is if you read the Old Testament, you will discover that over and over and over, the people had a struggle. The people had a problem. And you know what that problem was? They forgot. They forgot. They forgot their God who had brought them out of the bonds of slavery and brought them into a land of plenty. But you see, the crazy thing is that we are in a land of plenty. When we are in this land of plenty, we have a tendency to forget. To forget the way that God has blessed. To forget the way that God has watched over. To forget the way that God has simply taken care of our community. We have a tendency to forget. And yet Moses writes, when you're in the midst of that, just do one thing. Don't forget. You know, the amazing thing is you can go from Deuteronomy and you can read Joshua. Joshua, when they take the land, and you will find that by the end of one generation after Moses, after the end of Joshua's life, they've already begun to forget. And they begin to chase after the things of everybody else around them. All of these pagan religions, all these pagan thoughts, the people began to chase after them. Why? Because they forgot. And we look and we say, how is it possible that in one generation we could forget? In 1967, Ronald Reagan, in one of his speeches, he said this. He said, freedom, we are one generation away from extinction. When it comes to freedom, think of what that means. We are one generation away from losing freedom. Why? Because we forget. We forget the cost and the price that was paid. And yet Moses says, when I bring you into the land of plenty, do not forget. Have you forgotten? I know the crazy thing is that when you're preaching to a bunch of people who go to church, for many of us we'd say, well, no, we haven't forgotten. Or if we had, we wouldn't be here. But yet I wonder how easy it is for us to forget. You know, I think the older I get, the more I forget. The easier it becomes to forget. And especially when we have all that we need. But the beauty, I think, of this section of scripture is this. Even though Moses would write and say, the most important thing is to not forget this. I think that Moses lays out some thoughts for you and for me that will help us so that we do not forget. So that we stay focused on the things that are important, to make the main thing the main thing. And he begins by saying this in verse 4. He says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." Now, we read that, and we would think this, well, that makes perfect sense. But you know what? That idea of God being one has divided the church many different times. Because people would say this, well, I just want you to know, I'm a follower of Jesus. I don't like that God of the Old Testament, so I'm going to forget the God of the Old Testament, and I'm simply going to be the follower of Jesus Christ. But you see, as soon as we do that, there's this moment where we forget. We forget this God of creation, this God who's willing to lead his people out of bondage, this God who so deeply cared about relationship that he would create us to be in relationship with him. And yet we say this, well, I don't know that I want that God. Or for some of us, we would say this, well, you know, yeah, I understand God the Father, the Creator. I like that. I like Jesus. But I tell you what, there's some people who take the Holy Spirit and they kind of have gone a little bit weird. And I just don't want to get into that. So I'm going to simply stay away from the Holy Spirit. And I'm going to be a person of the Word, of the God of the Bible. And like I say, did you know that there have been controversies from the very beginning of the church, when the church has wrestled with this idea of the Trinity, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. That God says, I am one. And the, you know, you could, again, if you know your history, you go back to the very beginning of Scripture. And we can go back to creation. And the beautiful thing is that as you read the beginning, the history of how the world was created, guess who's all there at creation? The Trinity. The Father, the Son, and the Spirit are all right there in the beginning. So for you and I to simply say that, well, I don't want that. I want some of this. I'm not too sure about that when it comes to God. I'm not sure that we have the right to pick and choose. I'm not sure God is pleased when we say, well, I'll take that, but I don't want that. I don't want a God of justice, but I'll take a God of grace every day. Or I want a God of love, but I don't want a God that's going to hold me accountable. And yet Moses would write, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. So the first thing that I think that God would say to us today is, don't lose sight of who he is. As we gather together this community of faith today, whether Lutheran or Wesleyan or Reformed, don't lose sight of who God is. But then he says this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And then he says this, Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. See, the next thing that I think that God desires for us is that we would love him. And doesn't that seem crazy that we have to be reminded of that? That we say today as we gather together to worship, one of the most important things we can do, number one, is to realize who God is, but then to say this, to love God. To love God. He invites us into this relationship so that we might be in love with him as he is in love with us. And so love the Lord your God with your heart, with your soul, and with your strength. You see, I'm not sure that there's any part of us in the midst of that where we would say, well, I can keep this part of my life for myself. God, you can have all of this, but this part right here is mine. And I will do and choose to do with this section of my life whatever it is that I choose to do. I'm not sure that's what Scripture says. And yet I think that for many of us, we have fallen into this idea that if I give God Sunday morning, Wednesday nights, a few prayer times in the midst of the week, then I've done all that I need to do. But when he says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, strength, and mind, there comes this point where you go, wait a minute. That's everything. That's all of me. I sometimes feel that we've done this. that God was supposed to be the central part of our lives, that God was in the middle, and we look up to God, and we worship God, and we love God, and we celebrate God, and he was the central part of everything that we did. But somehow, at some point, we've done this. We've said, Jesus, I'm just going to move you right over here. And then we've gone and we've assumed the center part. Because you see, for many of us in our lives, everything flows from us. We've got things like work. We've got family. We've got our jobs. We've got our leisure activities. We've got vacations. We've got bills to pay. And then we just simply said, hey, God, is it all right if I'm just going to slide you right in here between job and family, and I'm going to give you this spot right here, God, and it's going to be all yours. And Jesus, you can have this spot right here. But all of this stuff, this is stuff I have to take care of. But when we read this, Moses says to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength. God never desired to be moved out of the central position and for us to assume that position. Because guess what? When we assume the central position and we simply say, God, come follow me all the way around here, I'll let you be a part of it. When we do that, we've done exactly what all of the people in the history as we read the Bible have done. They simply assumed that God would be okay with being part instead of the whole. And maybe today you come here and you might begin to look at your life and you might begin to think about the things and the history of your life, and you're going to discover that you've kind of moved God out. And it was so easy. It just kind of happened that you moved God out. And you say, God, I still love you. I do. But I need that central part. And Scripture says, no, hold on. That's not how the game is played. That's not how this relationship works. Yeah. If you are to love me with your whole heart, mind, and strength, then God says, I must be in the middle. So, God says this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. And then he says this, these commandments that I give you today are to be upon your hearts. And then I think he gives us some words that we should really take to heart today. And he says this, impress them on your children. Impress them on your children. I want you to think what that means. You see, in their day, one of the struggles that they had was that they began to chase the things of the world. And the things of the world became more important. And understand this, they didn't have schools like we have. You see, their schools took place at the synagogue, which was similar to our church, the church. And so they were brought up having this idea of faith, of knowing about God. But one of the things that Moses says is this, I want God to be so a part of your life that you will talk about it when you sit at home, when you walk along the road, when you lie down, and when you get up. See, there isn't supposed to be any moment in our life that is not centered around God. And so he says then, impress them on your children. So at their school, they would learn the scriptures. They would study the scriptures. In our culture, we've done a good job of doing this. I think we need to take the scriptures out. Because when we teach our kids, you know what? We're going to teach them about reading and writing and arithmetic, and the scriptures have no place. And when we do that, we've simply failed to follow what God has of us. So impress them on your children. You see, I think one of the greatest things that we can give to our children is faith. To bring them up in faith. To bring them up being able to say this, I don't know of a time in my life when God has not been central to it. You know, we live in a culture now, though, that says this, I'm going to let my kids grow up and they can decide if they want. I'm not going to force them to go to church. I'm not going to force them to read the Bible. I'm not going to force them to do anything. And so I'm just going to allow them to do whatever, and we'll see where we end up. That's a dangerous game to play. It's a dangerous idea for the church. It's a dangerous idea for the community. It's a dangerous idea for your family. To simply trust that it will just happen. Moses says, this is what I want you to do. I want you to realize God is one. I want you to love God, but I want you to impress it upon your children so that they simply know this is our history and this is our story, and they too will fall in love with God just the same way that you have. I had an opportunity this year to go up and celebrate in March up at the Denny Sanford Premier Center to watch Canton win their fifth state title in a row in wrestling. And so I got to cheer them on. I got to be a part of that. And you know, one of the things that I will say is that Canton has some pretty rabid fans when it comes to wrestling. They like their wrestling. And I enjoy it. I fit right in because I'm a wrestler as well. And so I fit right in, and I was able to be a part of that. And I see that, and I wonder that. But I wonder this, is that what we want Canton to be known for? Is that what we say that we would say? If Canton is known for anything, it's known for its wrestling history and the wrestling teams and the young men and young gals that we produce out on the mat who simply have the ability and the talent, and they give everything to be their very best and to continue the tradition and the history that we have. Is that what is most important to us? Or maybe your thing is football. Or maybe it's the rodeo. Fill in the blank. What is it that drives you? What is it that is your passion outside of faith? And think for a moment. Have you taught your children about rodeo? Have you taught your children how to ride horse? Have you taught your kids how to wrestle? Have you taught your kids how to throw a ball and catch a ball? And you say, I want to give you this upbringing because maybe, just maybe, you can become the very best at it. And you've said to faith, they'll get that. They'll figure that out. Moses would say, no, hold on. As soon as you begin to do that, you've got it backwards. Because that's not how it's supposed to work. Impress these things upon your children. Talk about them when you walk along the road, when you sit, when you lie down, and when you get up. Every aspect of your life. Because again, I think the greatest thing that we can leave as a legacy to Canton is a legacy of faith. A legacy of hope in what God desires to do through this community. The question maybe becomes, are you willing to be a part of it? Are you willing to be part of a legacy of faith that is passed on from generation to generation to generation? A legacy that says this,
Number one, that we believe in God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, that our God is one, and that we will love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our strength. And we are more than willing to pass it on to the next generation by impressing it upon our children. My friends, you are invited to be a part of that great history, that great story, that maybe 15, 20, 30 years from now, there will be a time when they gather in the park, and there will be so many people here that there will not be room for everyone to come because we've passed on that legacy of faith. Are you willing to be a part of that? Because I believe with everything in me that God is inviting us into that as well. Will you pray with me, please? Let's pray together. Father, today, God, we invite you, God, to come and have your way in us, to move through us. And Father, I pray that those places in our hearts that we've kept for ourselves, those places that we simply say, God, you can have all of these except this, whether it's family or job or leisure activity or vacation, God, that you simply today would come and you would begin to fill that place in us. And you would bring us back into the right relationship. That God, you would allow us to step down off of that mantle, to step down off of that pedestal. And God, we would give you the right to be God. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. So today we are grateful and we love you. And God, we worship you, and we thank you so very much for who you are. Father, I pray that you would be blessed by the words that we continue to sing, by the offering that we give you, so that in all things and in all ways, God, you are glorified. We love you. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
I'm just going to take a picture of the beginning of this legacy so in a couple of years we can see how much bigger you guys are. Smile. It's kind of a newer song. It's beautiful. You know, there's songs that we sing that say, woe is me, help me God, and this is one of those songs that says, God, you are good and you are awesome, and we're just going to praise you today.
Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb.
We have the opportunity to build this legacy, a legacy of giving, a legacy of generosity, a legacy of realizing that all that God has given us is true gift from His hand, and a legacy to pass on to younger generations, to future, to see that vision that Kevin so clearly cast in our message for this morning. So with those that are going to help with the offering this morning, please come forward at this time.
And as they're coming, I would just invite you to turn your attention to the envelope that was in your bulletin. If you don't have one, I'm going to send a couple of ushers around with those as well. There is a checkbox for you to check for your church. There's also an opportunity to financially support the Canton Ministerial Association Loving or your selected church. So just check the box for where you want your offering to go, and we'll make sure it gets to the appropriate spot.
Time I face the waves, I don't want to be afraid. Oh, I don't want to be afraid. And I don't want to fear the storm just because I hear the roar. I don't want to fear the storm. Oh, I don't want to fear the storm. Peace be still, say the word and I set my feet upon the sea till I'm dancing in the deep. Peace be still, you are here, so it is well. Even when my eyes can't see, I will trust the voice that speaks. I'm not gonna be afraid, cause these waves are only waves. Oh, I'm not gonna be afraid. I'm not gonna be afraid, and I'm not gonna fear the storm. You are greater than its roar. I'm not gonna fear the storm. Oh, I'm not gonna fear at all. Whatever my lot, thy
friends in Christ, let us pray that our love of God may become real and tangible in our love of our neighbor. Let us pause
for a moment of quiet prayer.
And then in the spirit of blessing this offering and blessing this day we've shared together, let us join together in the unison prayer that's at the bottom of your second inside page, and it kind of bleeds over onto the back. Let us pray. God, you display your power in loving us without regret. In the human heart of Jesus, your Son, you have shown us how
far love can go.
Give us a love that is forgiving, generous, and gentle like his, that we may recognize and welcome him and our brothers and sisters, and may our hearts reach out first to the poorest
and the least lovable
with the gratuitous love that you have given us in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And let us continue to join responsibly as we say our benediction together this morning. Dear friends in Christ, hear this.
The Lord our God is the one and only Lord. Therefore, we will go out into the world and love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love others as we love ourselves.
Dear friends, may God give you the justice and freedom. May Christ Jesus set us free for love. And may the Holy Spirit go with you
and protect you on the way.
We go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you.
much for coming out to the park today. It was wonderful to worship with you all today. We're just going to play a song to closing. If you want to dance and have fun in the park and to this song, this is one of those toe tappers. So it's not on your bulletin, but this is an awesome song. It's fun. Here we go. Hit it, bass player.
Trilogy. We don't communicate well, do we?
Washed in the blood of the Lamb, there's a fountain flowing from.
Hi, buddy.